Okay, hello everyone. This is a talk about Unix. And in particular, the command line bash. I'm going to introduce a lot of little commands and show you how to be proficient in the shell. And don't worry if you don't remember hardly any of these commands. It's more about knowing what the lay of the land is. And maybe if you learn a command here or there, that's good too. But it's mostly getting familiar with like this structure and this way of computing. It's quite different from like graphical interfaces, for example. So, history lesson time, because I think this kind of gives some context to why we use computers in this strange way where we type into little boxes all the time. So Unix was this really old operating system developed at Bell Labs, which is part of AT&T, a lot of good research in the 60s through the 80s. And there's this really excellent video I recommend that you watch. It's about people at Bell Labs, like Brian Kernighan and Ken Thompson, are just talking about the Unix system. It's really fun. But, okay, so why does Unix matter today? This is some 80s throwback. Why do we still care? Well, all of these things, Linux, macOS, Android, they're all based on Unix. They all kind of use those ideas. But more importantly, all of the toolchain for open source kind of pretty much assumes that you're in this kind of environment where you have programs and they write to standard out. More on that later. There's a nice history as well in the link. So, Unix was an early time-sharing system. These systems were built because you would have a very expensive computer and you would have a lot of people who wanted to use it. So the computer had to come up with a way to divvy out which programs should run when. And a lot of people would like be vying for the spot, you know, like the physics department versus the math department versus the computer scientists doing all kinds of wacky stuff. So the first interfaces used this thing called the teleprinter, which was basically a glorified typewriter. You would actually press, it was like a keyboard, like a typewriter keyboard, but you would type on it and the output of your commands would be printed to paper, to a line feed printer probably, or something like that. But what was nice about this is it had a very simple model, right? You type programs, or you type input on this keyboard, and you sort of get output, and sort of like direct, this direct transformation that happens. So later on, terminals came around, and these like saved on paper by having phosphor monitors, so you would see like this green and black layout. And but these machines couldn't actually do much themselves. They were mostly just, you know, you would plug it directly into the mainframe, and when you typed on your dumb terminal, it would go directly, probably over a wire, sometimes over the phone, to a mainframe. And so this was pretty much the same idea as the teleprinters, but a little bit nicer. But then came along microcomputers. So this is real computers where the CPU was like in a box, it could do stuff itself. And once we started having microcomputers, the need for mainframes really shifted. I mean, you still need like centralized server processing a lot of the time, but you can do a lot of that yourself. It's even better because you don't have to like be vying for resources and stuff. But all of that legacy from the timesharing era is still around because it was useful for other purposes. So, one thing that this teletype legacy was really good for is this idea of standard in and standard out. So that means every program, well, most programs can read whatever you type on the keyboard, right? And they print like to a printer originally, but now it's to the terminal session. And so this provided a really simple way of dealing with that stuff. And actually, the nice thing about the Unix system is that you can take chains of these commands. So instead of typing something yourself, you can get a program to do the typing for you, and you can create pipelines. And I'll explain that more in a bit. So Unix systems are generally organized, and this is true of most operating systems, into these basic areas. So there's the kernel, there's the shell, and then there's like utilities, the user land stuff. So the kernel is sort of like the resource manager. It's kind of like it decides when programs should run, which programs should have access to memory, because the memory pool on a system is kind of finite, so you need to be able to delegate to different processes so that they can access memory. And also, the kernel provides this kind of normalized manufacturers implement hardware in all kinds of different ways, and those can be really specific to one particular kind of hardware. So the kernel can help to make that a simpler interface, where the program knows how to talk to the kernel interface. It's the same, then they don't need to write different code for every kind of hardware that's similar, but from a different manufacturer that they would need to use. So one big thing, too, is that because of that standardization, Unix programs are really portable. So this is why you see so many different Unixes around. Those ideas are pretty transferable to a lot of different kinds of systems, like Linux servers or like your phone, if it's Android, for example. So that's I/O access. So another thing the kernel does with the CPU is scheduling. This is where multiple programs want to run, and you only have one CPU. So a CPU can only run a single instruction at a time. You can do that really fast, but you need this other layer, this kernel, to like kind of make sure that a single program can't hog the CPU for the whole time, so that you can do other things. And memory management is, you have RAM. Maybe you also have hard disk that you're using. When you run out of RAM, it's called swap space. And so the kernel keeps a table of that called the paging table internally. So the next kind of thing that a Unix system does is a shell. So a shell is a little program. It's just an ordinary program, but you can, so the shell is the program that kind of starts when the computer boots up, and it's the main interface to the program, or to your whole operating system. So the shell's job is to take the text that you type, like commands, and to run those commands, so basically it executes other programs. And it takes their output, their standard output, like they would be printing to the printer in the olden days, and puts it in the terminal session. And that's all that a shell's job is. And that's mostly what we'll be doing for the rest of this talk. Oh, yeah.
So is shell and terminal the same thing?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Okay. And so then shell is the part of the system that talks to the person. It's your connection to the computer.
Yeah. So the shell is your interface, your text-based interface for kind of issuing commands and doing other stuff. Of course, programs can talk to that same interface, but that's pretty much the case.
Okay. That's the command line.
Yeah. Right. So the next thing that Unixes have is lots and lots of utilities. These are ordinary programs that are nothing special. These are things that you might put on the system or expect to be installed already. Like all of the little commands that you may be typed a little bit, if you use the command line, like the ls command or whatever. These are all utilities. These are just ordinary programs that maybe read from standard in, maybe not, and maybe output to standard out and move files around, that kind of stuff. Just ordinary programs. And that's pretty much all that a Unix system evolves, is those three main layers. So I think one of the best reasons why this stuff is still important is that the conventions are really consistent. Like if you learn one little thing, like how arguments basically work, you can take that knowledge and transfer it to like thousands of programs, thousands of other programs that buy into that same system of conventions. So you can take small things that you learn and really extrapolate a lot with that small amount of learning. And there's this huge ecosystem that plays into that, that you can really put things together in a really nice consistent way. And it runs on all kinds of systems as well. So I already kind of mentioned this, but so one time, fun story, I was doing an nmap, which is a program you can use to scan your local network to see what's running, and I found that there's this SSH service running, which is a remote shell program, and I was like, where's that? I don't even know what that system is. That's not my laptop. That's not my friend's laptop. So what is that? It was my DSL modem, because my DSL modem that I got just from the phone company was running a Linux, and turned out their login system was the same as the web login, so I actually could log in, and they were running this small kind of Linux called BusyBox Linux. Then I played all around, and I like imaged the disk, and I had all kinds of fun with it. But that's just one kind of place where you might find Linux, and if you know the command line, you can really get in there and kind of have fun and make cool stuff with it. You might also see it on like Raspberry Pis are fun, or BeagleBone Blacks. They're like little tiny computers that run Linux, that kind of fun stuff.
Nice computer.
Yeah, little computer.
Tiny computer runs Linux.
Yep. So mentioned this, but the conventions that you get with these little tools you can use all over the place. And the ecosystem is really great, especially the ecosystem of open source tools. It's really fantastic, but it all kind of builds on a lot of the work that's been done with the Unix ecosystem. I mean, a lot of the free software movement came out of building a free, like, open source Unix, because the first Unixes were, like, kind of proprietary, and then later ones were proprietary, too. So it's kind of in the DNA of the whole open source ecosystem, and a lot of the documentation you might find kind of assumes that you're in that kind of environment. So text interfaces are really great, actually, because, and that's kind of what a shell gives you. And so this is really, really great if you just want to poke around, if you maybe the device that you want to interface with, like that DSL modem, doesn't even have a graphical port, right? How would you even plug that into something like a monitor, right? You can't, but if it has like a network card, you can plug into it over the network and be in a shell, a text environment, you can do a lot of stuff. And it's also really fun because you get to shuffle text around and you can like kind of plug programs and it's all very orthogonal. So a lot of those ideas about how to compose programs together well is this idea called the Unix philosophy. There's this really good book. Well, I don't know if it's a good book, all of it, but certainly the first chapter is very good. That's all that I've read. you can read it online at this website. It's by Eric Raymond. It's called, I think, The Art of Unix or something like that. But if you go to that link, it has this really great description of Unix philosophy, which is, I have some of these things here. These are from Douglas McElroy, who was at Bell Labs, and who kind of articulated very early on, in like the 1960s, a lot of these kind of ideas about how we can build complicated programs out of very small pieces that are independently useful. So, first idea, I'll just quote it directly. Make each program do one thing well. To add a new job, build afresh rather than complicate old programs by adding new features. This is because as a system grows, it doesn't grow linearly. You can't just add more features to an existing program with like the same amount of effort, usually. But if you build small programs, you kind of get, small programs are relatively easy for a single person or maybe a small team to keep in their head. So you can build small things and then at the very last part, just kind of plumb things together with pipes and stuff like that. So the second part of the Unix philosophy is to, this gets back to the teletype and printer, but it's to expect the output of every program to become the input to another as yet unknown program. Don't clutter output with extraneous information. Avoid stringently columnar or binary data formats. Don't insist on interactive output. So this idea is just about making the interfaces very clean and sort of austere, because you'll perhaps be running these kinds of programs a lot, and you don't want a simple command that, if it succeeds, which it almost always does, you don't want it like spamming you with output about like, oh, I copied the file okay, and I did this and the other, because you probably don't care about that. You only care about when it didn't work. So that's the main idea behind that idea. So third idea behind the Unix philosophy is to design and build software, even operating systems, to be tried early, ideally within weeks. Don't hesitate to throw away clumsy parts and rebuild them. I think this is a really good approach for software, too, not just Unix operating systems. But if you can get something very small working that maybe doesn't do everything, but it does enough, then you can kind of iteratively bootstrap that into something bigger, because you sort of establish this nice feedback cycle that your dopamine reactors are firing, and it's very fun. So, fourth thing, use tools in preference to unskilled help to lighten a programming task, even if you have to detour to build the tools and expect to throw some of them out after you finish using them. So, don't expect that you can just throw people on a problem, because people don't really scale as well as tooling does, because computers are meant to be automated. This one is less relevant today, but this was a very big thing in the IBM days when you could just throw people at a problem and it wouldn't work very well, but they would go somewhere with it. So, all that history out of the way to kind of establish some context, let's learn the command line. So, if you have a computer, I recommend that you get it out And feel free to just noodle around on the command line as I'm talking. You don't have to listen to me, but I'll be saying things. The notes and the video will be online, so don't worry about missing stuff. Okay, so the first thing you can do is open up a terminal or a shell, whatever it's called. Hopefully it's bash. You can tell that by doing echo shell, which should say something like /bin/bash if you're in a bash shell. There are lots of kinds of shells. Most of the shells roughly will work with bash-esque syntax, but the stuff that I will be showing is bash, so you'll have a better time if you're also using bash. Just saying. Okay, so yeah, you'll see something like /bin/bash if you echo $shell. I'll get into what all of this means later. Okay, so next. Let's do a fun thing. Let's list the files in whatever directory we happen to be in. So if I go to my home directory and I type ls, I see a bunch of files. That's cool. And that's all that ls does. Fun thing with ls, though, is you can provide it these things called arguments. So arguments are text that you give after the command. So here, if I do ls, I can just hit enter like before, or I can hit a space and then specify other things like dot, which is the same as listing the current directory, or I can ls slash, which lists everything at the root directory, which is kind of like the base of the whole file system. We can see all of these files. That's what arguments mean.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I understand ls is a command. Is it also its own program?
It is. So ls, you can actually run this program called which that tells you where that program lives. So this is a program that lives in /bin/ls.
Okay.
And
so then
I'll get in later into how that works behind the scenes. But yes, it is a program.
It sounds like it keeps going like which is a command that's also a program.
Yes.
Okay.
It's turtles all the way down.
Right.
There's only a few things that are built into the shell, but they mostly behave as if they're not built in. They could very well be programs. Yeah, in the back.
I'm not really understanding the bash thing. So if I have Ubuntu installed and I have a terminal open, does that mean I have bash and did you go?
Yes. If you type echo $, echo space $, and then shell in all caps, it should say /bin/bash. Great. Yep. So you're ready to go. Perfect. Okay. And feel free to butt in with your questions at any point, because that's very useful. Okay, so we listed the root. You can list whatever you want. And so you can also have multiple arguments. Like ls can actually take as many arguments as you like. So we can list the root directory, my home directory, and it'll actually print out both. So arguments are separated by white space, by spaces, usually. And you can give as many as you like to a command. Cool. So, another thing we can do is print out what directory we're currently in. Oh, yeah.
I just have a recommendation to pause a little bit as you're going along to allow people the opportunity to look at the screen and copy it onto the terminal.
Okay, great.
Yeah, thanks.
Yep. The next thing I wanted to show was pwd. This is a command. It's very simple. It just prints out where you are. So if you just type pwd, it should tell you where you are. If you open up a terminal, you usually start out in your home directory. So that'll be like something like /home/substack if you're on Linux, or like /users/whatever your username is if you're on Mac.
Sorry, I heard somebody else say the $ is printed to show, to indicate that you're at a prompt.
Yes.
And you're
yes. This is a very important convention. Thank you, Max.
Yeah.
So the $, don't type that. This is just, so it's a convention in Unix environments to show a $ when there's a command that you're supposed to type, but you should only type what's after the $. So you type this part. And then everything that's not that doesn't have a $ before it is the output of the program. And sometimes you'll see a hash instead of a $, and that means as the super user, so it's root, which we'll get into a bit. Yep, so if I type pwd for my home directory, I see /home/homestack. Great.
Any questions?
Questions on PWD.
Why is it named that?
It stands for Print Working Directory.
Working Directory. Cool.
Print as in printer, because these things used to be hooked up to printers.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, so another thing we can do is to change the directory that we're in. So we can use the cd command to do that. It stands for change directory. All of these commands are very terse because I guess they didn't like typing very much. They just sort of fired off something really fast. Okay, so cd, if you just type that without any arguments, just cd by itself, and you're somewhere. So here I'm in the root directory, but if I type cd, now I'm in my home directory. You can also give cd an argument. So if you give cd an argument like /var, then now I'm in /var. And now I can type cd, and I'm back in the home directory. Yeah, so this information on the left of my screen is called the PS1, or the prompt. It's just this friendly little thing that your shell will do to kind of help you to know where you are for you. So you don't have to type PWD if you don't want to. You can also configure that as much as you want to be all kinds of wacky things, but that's how mine is configured.
If I'm changing the directory, do I always have to put a slash to indicate what directory I'm trying to get into, like the slash before the directory?
No. I'll get into that in a bit, but if you put a slash at the start of a path, that means an absolute directory. So that will start from the root and go outward. But if you don't specify a slash in front, that's a relative directory. So it will start from your current working directory, and it will go into whatever is from there. So show that in a sec. I think I have something about it on the next part. So I'm just doing ls some places. So the fun thing to do is just cd into somewhere fun and do ls, and you can look around and you can cd into like fun directory, type ls, do pwd, and just kind of play around. Some important special directories. This is related to the question about everything starting with a forward slash. .. means go up a directory to the parent. So you might have seen this in some user interfaces taken from Unix. So if I go cd .. right now I'm in media /warp for my home directory. If I go to .. I'm just in media. If I go to .. again, I'm back in my home directory.
What if you do it again?
What if I do it again? Great question.
And what,
now I'm
do
in
it?
Home. What if I do it again? Then I'm in the root.
What if you do it again?
What if I do it again? Still in the root. So another fun thing is that you can actually combine these special paths. So if you want to go up two directories, you can do .. forward slash .. again. And that will get you up two directories at once. You could also, if I go back to where I was, mix and match these things. So if we want to go to ... /... that means the parent directory. Then we can go to another place, like we can go to doc. Now I'm in home directory /doc. Every time the shell sees, or the command in this case sees ... it's like go up directory, and then everything is based on that. So.
And there's CDs.
Yeah. Some other things is just a .. by itself means the current directory. So this isn't as common, but sometimes you need to use it. So if you want to go to like, if you want to ls, maybe the ls command doesn't, maybe you have a command like ls that doesn't implicitly list out the current directory, so you could tell it what the current directory is by doing ls .. instead. Those mean the same thing. And all of the rules about .. slash apply to .. as well, so you can do this as much as you want, and it doesn't do anything. It just means the same as .. And you can mix and match that with .. slash, with .. And it'll, yeah. Who knows what that means? Okay, I do. But okay, so another important thing is, you might have seen the tilde. That means your home directory. So tilde acts like, so if I go somewhere else, so you'll see that on the left my prompt is telling me tilde slash media. So I can also list out that directory directly by giving it that name. And this tilde is expanded by the shell to mean my home directory, which in this case those are the same. An important thing too is that we can like list stuff globally. So if we know the absolute path of something, the entire path from the root outward, then you can like ver spool, for example. Special paths. Play around. That's the best way to learn this stuff. Okay. Everyone got that. Great. So
can I just make a note? So the file system is one really big hierarchical tree, and nothing can't be reached from that. There isn't a file on your computer that isn't in that really big hierarchical tree that's starting from the root.
Yeah. So in operating systems like Windows, right, you might have C:/ hard disk, maybe like D:/ or your CD-ROM drive, something like that. In Unix systems, you don't have that. Everything is a single namespace. And if you want to have something like a CD-ROM drive, you typically put that in somewhere like /MNT or /mount, or /media rather. Like /media, USB, CD-ROM, whatever. It doesn't have a CD-ROM, but that exists. So those kinds of things are just mounted into that hierarchy. And your hierarchy actually could span a lot of different kinds of disks, actually. So you could have like one, you could have one directory for your root served up from a different hard disk than like your home directory, for example. Cool. /.
Is there any penalty for relative versus absolute?
No, it's just kind of like if you want to type all of that versus if you don't. So don't forget, CD will jump you back to your home directory if you get lost. So, yeah, in the back.
Yeah. This goes, I guess, back a little bit, but can you give us an example of a non-Unix base or a non-Unix-y system?
A non-Unix-y system?
Yeah.
Windows.
Yeah, and so what's the, I guess, how do you, you know, people that are using Windows, I guess yesterday you guys said that you can dual boot Linux, or you can use a virtual machine. I guess what is the sort of kernel in Windows?
The kernel is just the Windows NT kernel.
Own.
Yeah, so it's something. But organizationally, they're pretty similar. It's just that the Windows one is really weird, and it's really hard to make stuff work with it, because you have to write it specifically for Windows. It's not like a standard or anything. Okay, so let's get to another command. This one is called cat. So cat is fun. You can use it to see what a program, or what a file contains. So it was originally written in the days of tape archives when you would often have to concatenate files, hence the name cat, concatenate. It just means to take two files and smash them together. So if I have some files, like here I've just got some random files, I can see what's in that file by typing cat and its name. And all of the rules about paths that we covered earlier, like if I want to put cat something up from parent directory, apply. So just give cat a path, and it will show you what's in it. It was originally designed to work with multiple files, so you can of course give it multiple files, but that's kind of confusing because it's all squished together. But there was a point in time where that was a useful feature. So if you just find a file on your system using CD to move around, using LS to see what's there, then you can cat out a file. And one morning, if you accidentally cat out something like a WAV file or MP3 or something like here I'll do, then it will look like garbage. So you can, if that happens and it keeps going, hit Control C to kill it.
What does cat stand for?
Concatenate. Well,
yeah.
So Control C versus other control characters?
Yes. So the other control characters are used for different kinds of job control. There's Control B, Control Z, these all mean special things. I don't think I mentioned Control Z later, but Control B is kind of useful. If you actually type cat,
mm-hmm.
it just expects input from standard in, which is the keyboard. So it just echoes back what you told it.
Well, because it's concatenate, it literally is expecting, it will glue all your arguments together in a row. But in this case, you provided one argument. So
no arguments.
Or in no argument, and then you typed in one argument. So it glues one thing together with nothing else, and then displays it to you.
Well, no, this will just read from standard in, and...
And concatenate it with all the things that are also in standard.
Well, it concatenates it with just standard in, so it echoes, basically. And if you accidentally, if you type cat, you can kill it with control C, but that's kind of like hard killing it. If you do control D, that's like just ending the standard in output, sending an end of file. Fun thing to do. So find some files, use cat, go back.
So is it actually modifying the file, or is it just showing it?
Right, cat does not modify any files. It only shows them.
Well, you append? When you set it, append, or not append, but concatenates, does it?
In the output.
Yeah, only in the output. So it doesn't... It doesn't write that. The only place where cat writes its output is to standard out, which is just what you see on the screen.
But you can pipe it to the file.
Yeah.
Where we'll get to
yeah.
that later.
You can do fun stuff with it, but we'll get to that in a bit. Okay, so cat's pretty handy. There's some other commands we can use. One is called cp. This is the copy command. So you can use cp to copy the file from somewhere else. And then you have two files with the same contents. So let's make a file. So hang on, I'm going to do something and not explain it. Just so I have a file. And I'm going to move that file, which I'm also not going to explain yet. OK, so ignore that. Now we have a file. So we can use cat a.txt to see what it says. We can use the copy command a.txt to b.txt. Now we have two files, a.txt and b.txt, and they have the same content. Great. Works like you might expect. So cp takes just two arguments. So another thing that you can do with cp is you can copy entire directories. So to do that, first thing I should mention is that you can copy a file into a directory. So, like, hang on, I'm not going to explain that. But, so here we have a directory called wowwow, right? So if I want to copy a.txt into wowwow, I can do wowwow slash a.txt, but because that's first part is a directory, I don't actually have to do that. Those are the same. So that works, but also that works. Warning, if you copy over a file that already exists, it will be overwritten, and you will get no prompts, no notifications, nothing like that. That was actually mentioned in the Unix philosophy, one of the Unix philosophy topics. This is really useful because a lot of the time these commands will be automated, they'll be in scripts. And if a script is like waiting for user input, it's just, and there's no users around, then it's just going to sit there doing nothing. So that's why these work like that.
Is there an undo in case you accidentally overwrite a file?
There is no undo.
Uh-oh.
Yep.
Is there a way to tell it to give you warnings? I know, like, there's some ways that you can, like, when warnings are the default, you can tell it to ignore warnings.
So one thing you can do is read the manual page by typing man cp, and then you can read about what the options are. So there's probably an option for that. I don't know what it is, though.
I think it's dash I.
Yep, maybe. Interactive, yeah. That would be dash I, probably.
The way that you can avoid copying over things is if you're copying to another directory, ls in that directory and see if the file is already there.
Yep. Just be careful. Yeah. So another fun thing you can do is to copy multiple files because the destination is actually only the last argument. And you can provide as many arguments as you like. So we can copy like two files. If I make a new directory real fast, I can copy like a.txt and b.txt into xyz. And now xyz has two files in it. So that's a fun thing you can do as well.
And it'll make xyz from the home directory?
No, I just made it.
In the from the place you're starting with, it'll be an extension of where you're starting from or located.
Yeah, XYZ is relative to the current directory.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
If I wanted to copy everything in XYZ into wowwow, would I do cp XYZ slash star wowwow?
You could do that. Yeah, there's this thing called glob expansion. So you could do XYZ slash star to like wow. Also, a fun thing, if you start typing something, you can hit tab and it'll finish it.
If it exists.
It'll finish typing it if it can. The shell will, because the shell is smart like that. So, yeah, you can do that, actually. Let me delete that stuff. Yep, you can use stars. They expand. Be careful with stars, though. You might copy over things accidentally. Be careful. Okay. So another fun thing you can do, though, that's like star, is recursive copy. So if you have a whole nested subtree of files and things, you can use dash -r to copy stuff to your new place. So if I go to XYZ, maybe I make a new directory, maybe I make a directory var, whatever, right? So if I want to copy everything in XYZ, including all of the subdirectories, so if I try to just copy that, like, new XYZ, that won't work, because XYZ sees, or the cp command won't do that for directories by default. So what you have to do is give, this is called an option or a flag, to the cp command. It tells it to recursively copy everything. So once you do that, now XYZ has that. So that's what I typed earlier. Fun things about the shell, if you use the up arrow, you can go use the up arrow and use the down arrow now that you've had some history in your shell, and you can see everything you've typed. And if you're like, if you go up all the way and you're like, oh, now I have to go all the way down, just hit Control C and then it'll be good. Okay. So, just like the cp command can have this thing called recursive copy to copy all of the subdirectories, the ls command that we've already been using can do that too. So it takes capital dash capital R to make that happen. So if you want to see everything in a subdirectory, or everything in a directory and all of its subdirectories, like, you can just do dash R. So here I'll list everything in the media directory. That's all of the files, not just the things in the top level. So, and that kind of convention with like dash lowercase r or dash capital R is kind of widespread among a lot of tools that have recursive options to handle entire subdirectories. So if you know to look for that kind of feature, then you might find it in different tools. So
I'm confused about the convention. Why is there small and large cap?
I don't know why there's different ones, but I think, I don't know. It's just, that's a good place to look for it. Mm. These conventions aren't hard or anything. They're pretty, they're kind of hard to pin down, but they are widespread conventions. Mm. They're always a little bit different, but.
Each program gets to choose its own flags or options, and they, depending, like it might, LS